It means so many different things to people of all over the world. And if you condense the meaning of Easter down to one simple truth, you'll always end up with three words. Over and over and over again, three words. He is risen. Jesus of Nazareth is God in the flesh, full of grace, full of truth. He lives a perfect life in a broken world. He's crucified, dead, and buried. But the grave cannot possibly contain him. He is risen. Risen is the conquering and victorious king over sin and death. Risen to invite all people back into the abundant life their souls have been longing for all along. Fast forward 2,000 years. Those three words that have literally changed history now have the power to change us. For those who are lonely and full of doubt, he is risen. For those with songs of praise, and for those with cries of lament, he is risen. For the seeking, the broken, the anxious, the depressed, the successful, the young and the old, it's the presence of the risen Jesus that we encounter as the only one who can possibly carry us through it all. And God's priceless gift of salvation resurrects our own lifeless hearts and offers hope to a world that's dying for the sake of birth. All because, in the fullness of time, God wrapped himself in human flesh, stepped out of eternity, and chose a tomb outside of Jerusalem to communicate one simple and abiding truth. He is risen. And those three words have the power and the glory to change every waking moment.
Come, come and see that the tomb is empty. The stone has been rolled away and Christ has risen. Come and join us and sing with overflowing thankfulness at the hope that we have. Please rise.
We sing to the God who saves. We sing to given, accepting, reaching by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise, cause we were beggars, now we're royalty. We were prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, reaching by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Let's join the house of the Lord. Let's join the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Let's join the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Let's join the house of the Lord. Let's join the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Let's join the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Well, good morning. Be seated for just a second. We'll keep singing his praises in just a moment. But I just want to welcome you here in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome this morning. And on behalf of Arrow Lakes Alliance Church and Saddleback Community Church, I want to welcome you to our Easter service. And I'm so thankful that you're here and so thankful that you've come. And we're just so happy to have you here and sing praises together. And this, I won't talk a lot this time, but we got a great service today as we look towards Jesus, as we look towards Jesus for resurrecting and for life. And as we remember that he rose, we remember that he is risen. So praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary, praise him in his mighty heavens, praise him for his mighty deeds, praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud crashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We have breath this morning. Don't we have breath this morning? And we have breath because God has given us breath, and we are here to praise the Lord. Let me pray for us. Father God, I pray this morning as we come together to worship you that we would encounter you. And God, that you lead us here where we are. God, whatever week we came from, whatever year we came from, whatever morning we came from, whether it was the high of the highest mountains or the low of the lowest valleys, I pray that you would meet us here this morning. Lord, you would enlighten our hearts. You would draw us to you. You would reveal yourself to us in a new way, in a powerful way. In all that we do, you would be glorified. And Lord, today that we would know you. We would know you in a greater way. We would know you in a very real way. And that we would be transformed by your presence and by your glory. And that just as you have risen, that we will rise as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Preface this, all this singing here that you're going to do. You're not doing much, but we're a little bit there. I was preparing my heart all week for this by reading Matthew 28. And I'll just read the section that really, really got me because it was talking about women. It says, the angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he has said. Come and see the place where he lays. Then go quickly and tell the disciples. He is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him now. This is what got me. So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and they ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Rejoice," he said. They came to him and clasped his feet and worshiped him. When I got to that part, I imagined myself in front of Jesus. And I didn't just clasp his feet. I grabbed them and I hung on to them and I hung on to them and I hung on to them. I did not want to leave. The only thing I could do after that was stand and take my guitar and worship him. So that's what I did. And that's what I want you to do. Imagine that you're going to meet Jesus. You're meeting him now in whatever circumstance that you're in. And he loves you. He loves you more than anything. So please, rise with us.
One day when heaven was filled with
glory revealed. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sin far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day.
Here today to tell you how I came from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. And it's my story. Each of us have a different story. But it happened back in about 1978. I've been around 36 years old. And I was born in Nakusp, 1943. My parents immigrated. Mother was from the States. And I grew up in a normal family. I think my mom and dad were very good parents. I never ever once heard of a wife or anything. So I had a very good life as a child, and very good upbringing as far as secular upbringing is concerned. My mom used to go to church, and I would go to Sunday school a little bit, but I always thought she was a farmer or a shepherd. They never told me. And as I went on through school, I graduated and I went for 1 year to university school, Notre Dame College. And I wanted to work in the woods. That's all I wanted to do. So that's what I did. I went and got a job in the woods. And as time went on, I ended up running a logging operation here in Nakusp. Position. And then when they pulled it up, I went into business on my own, and I got one machine, and then I got another machine, and soon I had quite a good logging business at three separate sites, about 20 men working for me. And I had life pretty good. I was busy. I never gave much thought to God or anything. I tell people that when I died, I go 6 feet under, and that's it. And I was quite proud of that. I was a real man. And anyways, God kind of got hold of me when I was 17, around 32, I guess. I used to think going to church was just a way to die. Pretty baffled when I used to go to church. And I was taught evolution in school. So I had no real foundation whatsoever. But it's amazing. Like, for some reason, I had a fat back up a little bit. I got married and had two children, LD and Larry. When I started changing, I don't know, I didn't know at the time what was coming over me, but I started having thoughts of eternity and what was going to happen to my family and me. Is there any hope of life after death? Yes, and my wife at the time, Wendy, she was singing in the United Church choir, and the pastor, Derek Sherrier, he was at our house one night, and he found me on the church. And I thought, well, I'm going to church. And I wanted to read the Bible. And I thought, well, you know, how do I know which church to go to? There's so many different denominations, so many different religions. How do I know? So anyways, I did start reading the Bible, and I thought, well, I'm going to find out for myself. I'll just read it and see what I can get out of it. And I got as far as about the end of Genesis, and King James Version Bible. And I just gave up. But about 2 or 3 months later, there was a church meeting in my house with my wife in the choir. Anyways, there was a fellow came from, he said he was from South Lake, you know, so about 23 years old. And he told me, he said, Doug, he said, you got to read the New Living Bible. He said, don't read that old. King James Version. So read the New Testament too. Don't read the Old Testament. And he talked for a while, and I started reading the New Testament, and the words just came alive. And I thought, this really makes sense. And I really started getting some understanding. But I read a scripture in there, and Jesus said, John said, if you do not believe who I claim to be, you will die in your sin. And I thought, well, who is Jesus really? Is he? And the Holy Spirit said he's an angel. Others would say, no, he's God and flesh. I thought, well, I have to know this because if I get it wrong, it's a big issue. So I really searched the scriptures. And I did find, and I remember praying to speak again. I remember I was really getting serious about knowing God at this time. And, I remember one night I just laid on the floor of the bed and I said, God, if you're real, if you made me, you should be able to show me what salvation is, what I have to do to know you and to have eternal life, or whatever you have for me. You can make this body and all of the creation of God. You actually made it. You should be able to build that one. Well, he came to me. Like, in a year's time after reading the Bible, I knew the Bible said Jesus was God. There's no ifs or buts about it. He was God in the flesh. And it didn't matter what denomination you went to originally, it mattered what you believed about Jesus and what he's done for you. I realized I had no way, there's no way I could save from my sin. And so I accepted Jesus as my Savior for my sin. And through that, I know by the Word of God that I have eternal life. Now, it was a real moving time for me. I was so excited about my newfound faith. I told others. I was before I believed. What are you talking about? And it's amazing to me. I can fast forward to now. A lot of stuff happened. I went through a divorce. Very hard things to go through. And God was with me through it all. He brought to me a great wife, Janet. And we've been solid in our faith. And it's just an incredible blessing to know where I come from. Why I'm here and where I'm born. I know the world today has so many questions and there's so much confusion out there. And I just implore anybody that don't know the Lord Jesus, get to know him because he's coming back and he's coming back to him. And he takes away all your fears. Fear of death is gone. I'm not afraid to die. Do this whole COVID thing. Yes, everybody has their different times, but honestly, if God's going to take me, he's going to take me. And I have no fear. I'm in his hands, and I'm just so thankful, so grateful. I went from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and behold, who is my Savior, my God. Thank you.
So as parents, grandparents, do the best that you can to raise them, to look at Jesus for all our time. Thank you.
Thank you. must be sure this little lamb doesn't run away. And I told them, Moses, Father Abraham, and I said, you children, watch the lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers there, no joyful worship songs. And I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then suddenly the crowd cried out, let's crucify him. Well, we tried to leave this city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, one I did not want to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? And why just standing right here, where soon they would pass by. Well, I looked and I said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. And then someone yelled, there's Jesus! I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten that he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns on his brow, running down upon the cross and falling to the ground. Well, I watched him as he stumbled, and I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, and the crowd began to yell. Seems such love in everybody's eyes. What's my fate? Bury his cross. At first I tried to reach his tip, but his hand reached for his sword. So I knelt and I took the cross from the Lord. I put it on my shoulder and we started down the street. And the blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. For they led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. Yet upon the cross I heard him say, Father, give them. Never have I seen such love in any other's eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt these little hands holding on to mine. My children stood there weeping, and I heard the elder say, Father, please forgive us what the Lamb we see.
There was a woman one day on her way to Easter Sunday, Easter service, and on the way her car broke down. And she didn't want to miss the special service, so she picked up her phone and she called an Uber. And the Uber came and she got in the back seat. And as they started driving away, as they started driving to the service, she leaned forward and asked the driver a question. But the driver didn't respond, and so she waited a second to let him respond, and then she reached forward and she tapped him on the arm. The man let out just a loud scream, and he swerved into the other lane. He almost hit another car. He slammed on the brakes, and he skidded over to the shoulder. The woman and the driver sat in silence for a minute after the shock of what happened, and finally she said apologetically, "I'm so sorry. I didn't know that I would startle you so much by tapping you on your shoulder." And the driver took a deep breath and he said, No, it's okay, you didn't do anything wrong. You see, it's just my first day driving an Uber. For the past 25 years, I've driven a hearse. It'd be quite the shock to feel a tap on your shoulder if you're the driver of a hearse. It means your occupant, your passenger, does something miraculous. Something completely and totally unexpected and extraordinary, it would mean that he had risen. Let's look to the Word of God. This is Luke 23. It was now about the sixth hour. Where am I? 24. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And the women found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. Is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified on the third day, rise." Father God, we pray today that as we look at your word, God, as we consider what the resurrection of Jesus means to our lives, that you would break through our hearts of stone. God, you would break down any walls that we've erected. You would break down the resistance that we have. You would break down our pride. And God, you would come into our lives. And we would truly hear the truth this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So Easter Sunday, the women get up early, they get all prepared, they get the spices ready, they get everything ready. They're going to go to the tomb, and they're going to take care of a dead body. They're going to take care of this dead body of Jesus. They were there. They saw him crucified. They saw him die on the cross. The Romans were really, really good at one thing, and that was killing people. They were experts at killing people. They didn't make mistakes when they killed people. They saw Jesus die on the cross. So they get all prepared and they go to the tomb and they're going to take care of the body. They're going to get them ready for a proper burial. And they go and they get to the tomb and there's no body. Jesus isn't there. And what they found was far more than they could have imagined, far more than they bargained for, far more than they ever could have hoped. You see, Easter at its core is a great surprise. It's a great surprise. It's a great shock. It's something that we could never have dreamed up on our own. The tomb was empty. The tomb is still empty. There was no dead body. Jesus had risen from the dead. You got all prepared this morning. Maybe you woke up early. Maybe you got dressed in nice clothes. And you came here. What did you come to find? What did you come to see? Great people? Great music? An engaging and handsome speaker? I mean, like 2 out of 3 is not bad, right, Dan? Huh? I'm hoping you're going to find more. I'm praying you're going to be surprised by Easter. You're going to be surprised by what you find. I'm praying that you're going to find more than what you expected, more than what you could have hoped for, more than what you could have dreamed for. I'm hoping that if you're here this morning and you don't know the hope and the joy and the peace and the salvation that Doug talked about that comes with knowing Jesus, that you're going to find it. And you're going to leave here today with a new eternity, as a new creation, as a child of God. And I'm praying that if you do know Jesus, that if you've been saved from sin, if you've been saved from death and the devil, and your citizenship is in heaven, that the Lord would renew and refresh you this morning. And you would leave here more committed to Him and more committed to His kingdom. And so wherever you are, I've been praying all week. I pray that you will know anew and afresh the surprise of these three words: He is risen. These three words are often repeated: He is risen. In church tradition, the tradition is when somebody says He is risen, the response is what?
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. That's the church tradition. But more and more in our world, it's a different response. More and more in our world, the response comes back: Jesus is risen. The response comes back: so what? He's risen, so what? So what if He is risen when I'm mired in sin? Not only am I mired in sin, but sin just looks so attractive to me, and I feel weak, and I feel unable to get out. So what if He is risen when I've been betrayed by somebody I love? So what if He is risen when I'm struggling with my marriage, fighting with my kids, wondering where the next meal is going to come from, or dreading going to work the next day? So what if He is risen? I look around and I see a world that doesn't make sense. A world that calls good evil and calls evil good. A world that doesn't hold any hope, that doesn't offer any joy, that seems completely void of peace. So what if He's risen when I live in that world? So what? What does it mean to me? Why should I worry or care about that at all? What impact does it have on my life? The story of Easter is far more surprising and far more exciting than it's often portrayed. It's completely world-changing. It takes everything we know and it turns it upside down. In The Lord of the Rings, Samwise Gamgee, after being saved from the fires of Mount Doom by the eagles, waked up, sees the wizard Gandalf, and he asks this question. He asks Gandalf, he says, "Is everything sad going to come untrue? Is everything sad going to come untrue?" The answer that we get from Easter is yes. Everything sad is going to come untrue. And the fact that He has risen is the first step in that journey. So what is this Easter story that's so surprising and so shocking? Here's the story. God created a good world. God created you. You are not a cosmic accident. You are not the product of a billion years of star stuff banging together. Some of it made rocks, and some of it made trees, and some of it made weasels, and some of it made you. You have been lovingly created by a creator. Lovingly made. You have value. You have worth, and you are unlike anybody else. You are completely and wholly unique, made in the image of God, male and female, made in the image of God, and meant to be part of His family and to rule over His good world forever. But sin entered the world, and through sin, death entered the world. And death came to all people. And so instead of being part of God's family, we went our own way. We turned away from Him. We all fell short of His perfect glory. We all sinned. And because the wages of sin is death, we all earned death. Look around the world today. The results of sin are everywhere. All of creation groans under the weight of it. Both natural and supernatural powers and principalities are corrupted by sin and the effects of it. Instead of following God's commands, we followed our own lusts. We followed our own desires. And many have suffered terrible things because of it. And because we gave ourselves over to sin, we became slaves to it. And we all became spiritually dead, unable to come into the presence of God because of our rebellion and because of our darkened thinking. But God, our God, in His great grace, He's not like an evil father who sees his children drowning and just yells at them to try harder. And just yells at them to try this or try that. And if they don't, leaves them to drown and die. No. He's not like the so-called gods of the other religions who looks down on humans and says, just do these things and you can make it up here to me. Just try harder. As if the problem that we have in our hearts and in our lives is a lack of effort. No. No, see, our God sees us. Our God sees you. And He knows you. And He knows your predicament. And He knows where you are. And He knows the thoughts of your mind. And He knows the desires of your heart. And He knows that you're held in bondage to our own sin. He knows that we're held in bondage to our own flesh. He knows that our eyes are veiled to the truth. You ever felt trapped? I'm sure you have. Ever felt you needed to break free of something that was holding you back? The reason why you feel that way is because you are trapped. All of us are trapped, and God knows this. Instead of just telling us to try harder to get ourselves free, He comes. He comes to make us free. He takes on flesh, becomes a man, born of a virgin. He comes and He lives with us. He identifies with us. He goes through the struggles we go through. He knows the pain we experience, and He does it all without sin, perfectly. The only one who ever has, and the only one who ever could. Our sin earned us death. But His sinless perfection earned Him life. And it doesn't give the life of himself. He gives it to us. He gives it to you. It was for you. Instead of keeping the life that He earned for Himself, He willingly gave it up. The sinless Savior gives up His life willingly and is killed on a cross. He gave Himself as your sacrifice. And all your sins that had earned death were given to Him. All those debts that you racked up with God. All the times you broke God's laws. All the times you fled from God. All the times you hid from God. All the times you rejected God. All the times that you sin had run up quite a bill. You had quite a tab. We all had quite a tab. And all of it. Every cent was poured out on Jesus. And He was punished for every single one. So that you never have to be. He paid it all. He wiped your tab clean. But even more than that. Even more than that. See, God just doesn't leave us alone to face death on our own. With our list of goods and bads. As if we would stand before death by ourselves alone. Here's what I did well, and here's my bad things. And trust that this list is better. He doesn't leave us to that. He takes our tab, He wipes our slate clean. Not only does He wipe our slate clean, He takes all of His credits that He earned with His perfect life, and He fills your slate with it. He beats death at His own game. He fills it with His credits. See, it's not just that we're forgiven of all our sins. It's not just that we're wiped clean. It's that we're filled with His life. We're given the life that Jesus earned, a full life, eternal life, life after death. And this life isn't just an extension of your biological existence. Just don't live a whole bunch longer. This life is a complete transformation of your existence. This is the story of Easter. This is the story of the Bible. This is the truth of the world. You ever had somebody call you from a number you didn't recognize? Right? You look at your phone and it's a number you don't recognize. And against your better judgment, you answer it because it might be important. It never is. But it might be important this one time. And you find out on the other end that you have won a cruise. Anybody want a cruise? Right? I've won so many free cruises, I could spend the rest of my life on a boat. If I would just call back this number or pay the taxes, right? And it sounds too good to be true. The offer seems far too good to be true. And of course it is, right? There's no cruise. There's only a scam, which results in loss of time, a loss of identity, or a loss of money, or all three. And yet many people keep getting taken in by this scam. Why? Because they want it. Because they want what's offered. We want the cruise, don't we? Think about how nice it would be just to leave this life behind and go kick it on a boat. Think of how much fun we would have. We want what they're offering, and so sometimes we're willing to take the risk. This is like the offers of the world and the offers of the devil. If you just follow me, I'll give you everything your heart desires. Just indulge in every whim or every fantasy. Just follow your heart. Just put yourself on the throne. Just do what you feel like. Just rub this crystal. Just say these words. Just do these things. Just sell your soul for pleasure or money or comfort, and then you'll find the hope and joy and peace that you're looking for. And why do people do that? Because we want it. We want hope. We want joy. We want peace. We have this deep gnawing on our souls for more, for something bigger, for something deeper and higher and wider and greater. And even though we know that the offer of the world looks too good to be true, we run after it and we grab onto it, only to find in time that there's no free cruise. And there's no hope, and there's no peace, and there's no joy, and there's only despair. 100 years ago, a German pastor by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer was writing between the First and the Second World War. And what he wrote 100 years ago, pretty much bang on 100 years ago, describes our time today as well. He says that a searching, an anxious groping and questioning for divine things permeates our age. A great loneliness has come upon our age, the kind of loneliness found only in a God-forsaken age. The enormous distress of isolation and homelessness have come upon the colossal wild activity of countless masses of people in the midst of our big cities. Yet the yearning grows for a time when once again God might abide among human beings. When God might be found. A thirst for contact with divine things has come upon people, a burning thirst demanding to be quenched. And currently, a great many remedies are being offered for sale that promise to quench this thirst in a radical fashion, and which for which hundreds and thousands of hands greedily reach out. And in the midst of all this wild activity and marketing frenzy with new means and new ways, we find the one word of Jesus Christ. I am here. You don't need to search very far. You don't need to question or engage in all sorts of mysterious activity. I am here. We might say, well, the offer of Jesus sounds too good to be true. The free offer of forgiveness and life, the offer of salvation, which brings hope, joy, and peace, the offer that Jesus paid it all. And all we need to do is repent and put our faith in him to gain his eternal life that he gives us. That offer might seem like a cruise phone call or one of the great many remedies being offered for sale out there. just another dead-end empty path being peddled by dishonest men. Listen, I'm here this morning because I care about your souls. I'm here this morning because I care about your eternity. I care about truth. I care about life. And I look around our world and I see so many people who don't have the hope of Jesus. And I see so many people who are so deep in despair that they're grabbing on to anything that they can reach in order to try to quench that thirst for divine things. And I see people going after worthless things and trying to fill that hole with drugs or sex or social causes or the latest fad or whatever hodgepodge of different things from different spirit with different religions cobbled together. And I see people who are deceived by evil spiritual forces that don't lead to God, but just lead to death. And I'm here to invite you to join me. Not because I'm amazing, not because I'm great, not because I got it all together. God knows I don't. But I'm one starving beggar trying to show another starving beggar where to find bread. Where to find living water that'll quench that thirst that you have. That'll quench that yearning that you have for contact with divine things. It's not found anywhere else. It's only found in knowing the Most High God, who is not distant, who is not hidden, who loves you. Who loves you with a love that you can't even understand. Who loves you with a love so great that he would send his only son to die for you, that whosoever believes in him might not perish but might have eternal life. I'm here to invite you to take that journey, take that adventure. To walk together on this adventure as we walk towards that place where everything sad becomes untrue. And so what? He is risen, so what? So there's real forgiveness. Real and true forgiveness for your sins. It's not offered by anyone else or anything else. There is no absolvement in any other belief system or anything else out there. It doesn't matter what your list of good deeds is. We don't seek life among the dead, but come to the source of life to find life. So what? So there's a way to eternal life. There's a way to eternal life. And you can have it. You can have eternal life. It's not offered by anything else. And God loves you more than you can understand. And that's not assured by anything else out there. So what? So there's hope. Because Jesus rose from the dead, we have hope that all the injustice of the world one day will be dealt with. So there's joy, because Jesus has risen, we have joy. Not joy that is fleeting because we had a good day or we had a great sandwich, right? Or we watched a good movie. But joy that goes past all those things, transcends all those things, deep abiding joy, knowing that we are deeply, deeply loved. That we are God's children. And we don't need to wonder, am I loved? There's peace. Because Jesus rose, we have peace with God. both today and into eternity. And as Jesus fixes our relationship with our Creator, He also begins fixing our relationship with others, and we can have peace between one another. And you can have peace with yourself. You can have peace in your soul. We want peace in our soul. We want to lay down our heads at night on our pillow in peace and know that God is in control and God is in control of our life. So what? That He's risen? So it means you and I will rise. It means those of us who have faith in Jesus Christ will rise to eternal life. But the flip side of that is those who don't have faith won't. Are you willing to take the step to find out the truth? Are you willing to step into the adventure? And if you're already in the adventure, are you willing to grab on even more and fully immerse yourself in the adventure of God? How about we take the so what? How about we change the so what, He is risen, to now what? He is risen, now what? Now repent and believe. Accept the gift. Join the adventure. Become new. Leave all that junk and baggage behind you and rise to a new life. Jesus is calling your name. Jesus is tapping you on the shoulder. How will you react? It's all possible. And it's all true because He is risen. Amen? Amen. Let me pray. I'll invite Michael and Michelle up as I pray for you. Father God, we thank You for all You've done for us. We thank You for how much You love us. We thank You that You invite us into Your presence through the blood of Jesus and that we can truly be forgiven. And God, I pray that as You work on our hearts, Lord, that we would be blessed and energized, that we would be convicted and transformed to take another step in the adventure of knowing the one true God. Amen.
They say you're not supposed to put all your eggs in one basket. I'm going to put my eggs all in this basket. Jesus is waiting. So we will ride with Him. Join us, please. I will ride.
The shadow of this sun.
So again, I just want to thank you for coming and being here with us this morning. And I want to encourage you that if you want to take this adventure and take this step, you can come and see me. We have some resources over on the table there if you want to know more about Easter. If you want to, if Doug's testimony touched you and you think, well, I want to take that challenge and read the Bible, come and see me and I'll have a Bible for you. If you are a believer in Christ and you're not engaged in a faith community, I want to encourage you to get engaged in a faith community. Saddleback Community Church meets at 10:30 every Sunday. Arrow Lakes Alliance Church, my church, meets at 10 a.m. every Sunday. We want to invite you to come and be part of this adventure of following Jesus. Before you leave, I want to invite you to grab a hot cross bun, a coffee, water, juice, whatever's there, and just spend some time speaking to people. And now I want to bless you. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Brothers and sisters, you are sent out into the world to share the life that we have in Jesus Christ. Go now in peace. Amen.